It was almost like a fairy tale.
We put Motown on the map.
The Beatles did Mr. Postman. That record is really, really important.
They just kept going and going, hit after hit.
Don't mess with the Beatles.
They set the pace for all the other girl groups that followed.
They had some unfortunate situations, a lot of them in the one group.
Every one of them had horrible things that happened in their life.
You fear that they're gonna OD or somebody's gonna hurt her.
They didn't care anything about me, so why would I care anything about them?
Anyone that sells a million records and it takes 43 years for you to even get your recognition is unsung.
Uncompromised. Unrecognized. Unparalleled. Unsung. The story of the Marvelettes. In the early 1960s, Motown had a girl group that burned up the stage and the pop charts.
I heard about the lovers you had before.
And it wasn't the Supremes.
Oh, yeah. You can have this dance with me.
The Marvelettes may be the most underappreciated, underrated artist at Motown.
The Marvelettes kicked the door open and let everybody walk through.
They came sort of like outside into Motown and got the hit record first.
And my number is Beachwood.
Indeed, the Marvelettes, five high school girls from nowhere, gave Motown Records its first number one pop hit and cracked the R&B top 40 18 times.
They really were the answer to Motown's prayers.
Everybody would start being developed from that one spark.
The Marvelettes' music was built to last, from rough-edged R&B to sophisticated soul. But as Motown's star rose higher, the Marvelettes faded from view, as a stunning series of ill fortunes claimed one member after the next, until there was no one left at all.
Georgiana dropped out of the group because she had sickle cell.
Juanita had, they said, a nervous breakdown.
Wanda would drink and sometimes black out for days.
This was really a tragic set of circumstances. It's not the way that you want things to evolve when you're a pioneer of this wonderful kind of music.
All of a sudden, they weren't recording anymore. The Marvelettes shouldn't have never died the way they died.
The five women who would give Motown their first number one pop hit, Gladys Horton, Katherine Anderson, Georgiana Tillman, Juanita Coward, and Wanda Young, grew up together in Inkster, Michigan, 15 miles west of Detroit, and a world apart.
I remember back in the day, they had dirt roads. Some people still consider it a country town.
It was like a little hickish. You know, it was not no metropolis by no stretch of the imagination.
Inkster has always been and still is country.
This is the house that I grew up in. Georgiana stayed right there, and Juanita stayed right across the street. So we were very close in proximity. Juanita, Georgiana, and myself, we used to always get together and play cards and dance and clown around. We were very good friends.
We did join the glee club in high school. And after that, I think that was like in the ninth grade. The next year, we joined the chorus.
In 1960, a new girl moved to town and joined the chorus, Gladys Horton. And when it was announced that the three top winners of the school talent show would get an audition with Detroit's hot new label, Motown, Gladys grabbed the reins.
Gladys said, we're going to be in that talent show.
Gladys really wanted it, and she wanted it bad.
They asked the other music teacher, Nika, they used the music room to practice some of their routines. Not only did they have the music memorized, the songs memorized, but dance steps.
To bolster their chances, Gladys reached out to another teenager, Georgia Dobbins, who had been singing with groups for years.
They all came over to my house. They were excited. They wanted to be in this talent show. And, you know, I done graduated from high school. I'm older than they are. So my mother said, stay with them and help them out. I said, okay.
Calling themselves the Cansignettes, a contraction of can't sing yet, the quintet performed publicly for the first time at the talent show and came in fourth. But a school counselor named Shirley Sharpley thought the girls should have been first.
So Gladys Horton said, you really think so? I said, yes. She said, well, you know, do you think you could get us an appointment with Motown?
Mrs. Sharpley, she contacted Barry, and we had an audition with Barry Gordy.
Robert Bateman, the Motown producer who discovered Mary Wells, was at the audition.
They knocked me out. And when I say they knocked me out, everything that everyone else that heard them didn't like is what I did like. They sounded like kids. I mean, little kids. But I mean, in harmony.
But the Cansignettes didn't have any original songs. So when Barry Gordy suggested they come up with fresh material, Georgia Dobbins determined to do just that.
My piano player, William Garrett, had a whole bunch of songs, and he had this title, Please, Mr. Postman.
She asked if she could have the title, and from there she went and began to start writing the song.
Well, I was dating a guy, and he was in the Navy. And I was looking for a letter. I was standing by the window, and I was just standing there like that, waiting on the mailman, and the mailman was jumping through. And, you know, started coming to me. You don't have no letter today for me? You see what I'm saying?
A few days later, the girls brought the song back to Motown and auditioned it for Smokey Robinson.
I started to sing, and then he said, hold it. And he went upstairs and brought down Barry, Diana Ross, Martha Reeves. And they all came down, and Barry said, let's sign them up.
Barry renamed the group the Marvelettes and offered them contracts. But there was a hitch. The girls were all underage, and Georgia's dad refused to sign.
See, he worked two jobs, Ford and the gas station. I was like a caretaker, and I had six brothers. Dad said no. I ain't mad at him, because Mama can't get up some days. But it hurt now. I ain't gonna tell no lie.
As she was leaving, Georgia Dobbins passed the torch to Gladys Horton.
I said, you're gonna have to take over for me. And so I taught her how to sing.
She said, Georgia really told her, no, you can do it. You got the voice. And I thank Georgia to this day.
To fill out the group, Gladys turned to another team from Inkster named Wanda Young, who had just graduated from high school and was planning to become a nurse.
Gladys came over to my house and asked me,
What part can I sing, alto, or can I sing soprano? And I told her, I said, Gladys, I can sing all of it.
With Gladys singing lead, Please Mr. Postman was released in the summer of 1961. Within days, it was on the radio.
There must be some word today, yeah, from my boyfriend so far away.
I heard it on WCHP. Oh, I ran through the house. I woke everybody up. I could hear myself in the background. That's me singing. That's me in the background.
So many days you passed me by. You saw the tears standing in my eyes.
What does she really know about Mr. Postman? I mean, she's 15 years old. Nobody bringing her a letter. But Gladys had this raw ability to sell the song.
Within weeks, the song appeared on the pop charts and rocketed all the way to the top. Motown's first number one pop hit.
Wow, they got a hit right out the gate, you know, and I said, well, maybe one day it'll happen, you know, for us.
Mary Wells was there, The Miracles was there, The Temptations was there, but we put Motown on the map. Five girls from Inkster with Please Mr. Postman.
With Please Mr. Postman, five teenage girls from Inkster had helped put Motown Records on center stage, while overshadowing the company's other fledgling girl group, known at that time as the No-Hit Supremes.
We always were a little hurt because they came sort of like outside into Motown, invaded our territory. It was just like, we were the first ones here. We should have the first hit record, you know, that kind of thing. But we still remained friends.
The Marvelettes followed Postman with more dance hits, including a song that tied up phone lines from coast to coast.
Fans from all over called Beachwood 45789, thinking that that may have been one of our phone numbers.
Beachwood 45789, you can call me up another day, call me old time.
The people that had the exchange was quite upset with her because they received a lot of calls. They had to end up changing their numbers. And to you, I'm sorry.
But with overnight success came a hard choice: pursue their new career or graduate from high school.
Barry told us that we would have tutors, so that helped us to make our minds up.
I don't remember any tutors. Sometimes we studied when we were performing, but overall we didn't, because the performance took precedence over the studying, and so then we all ended up dropping out of school.
So the Marvelettes hit the road, joining groups like the Miracles, the Temptations, and the Contours on what was called the Motortown Review.
Barry came down and talked to everyone, and he told us how he wanted us to, you know, be gentlemen, ladies, you know, and don't shame the name Motown. And then he ended, he said, oh, by the way, you girls, all you ladies, stay away from the Contours. They're hoodlums, they are bad boys. But the Marvelettes, and matter of fact, none of the girls had anything to do with us on the first part of the tour, the first month anyway.
As it happened, Georgiana Tillman eventually married Contour singer Billy Gordon.
Talking about five girl guys, you know, four or five girl women, you know, so if you're on that bus long enough, you know, one-nighters, and, you know, so, yeah, things can happen.
Meanwhile, Wanda Young dropped off the tour because she was pregnant with her first child. But since few fans had actually seen the Marvelettes, her place was briefly taken by the Supremes' Florence Ballard.
They had to teach Florence their way of moving, because we had our way, and they had their, well, not really moving, the choreography.
Florence worked very well with us, but she was no dancer.
The Motortown Revue played up to 6 shows a day. For Juanita Coward, the pace was overwhelming.
I wasn't getting the rest that I should have been getting. And I wasn't eating as well as I should have been eating. I developed health issues that I had to leave the group.
Doing the routines and doing the rehearsals and stuff like that, it's a never-ending process. Her drive was not the same. And she realized that show business was not for her.
But the rest of the Marvelettes remained hungry for success. And when Wanda returned, they tore up the stage with a show-stopping hit called Locking Up My Heart.
I'm holding up my guard. I'm locking up my heart. Telling the Cupid to pass by me, cause all of them about me was a misery. Hello, loneliness, goodbye, love. I'm tired of being the blues, I'm being the shoes. I'm having a sheer romance, no more for me. I'm locking up my heart and throwing away the key. Lock it up.
When you're 16 and 17 years old, you could dance all night in your heels.
That was the first record that Gladys had to share leads with Wanda. That may have caused a little friction within the group, but it worked good as far as on the record. Very good.
They had those little tight fitting dresses and showing those nice legs, and we said, my Jesus Christ.
John Lennon take the stage once more for their offering of the record, which is doing so much at present for the Marvelettes. Here now as they cry, please, Mr. Postman.
In 1964, the Beatles stormed America with an amazing repertoire of original songs and a powerhouse version of Please, Mr. Postman by the Marvelettes.
It just really, really caught everybody's attention. Said, you know, that record is really, really important. And it made a big difference in the longevity of it.
My dad heard about it. He said, God, he said, I wish I had a sign now.
That same year, Motown's other girl group scored their first number one hit with an irresistible melody written by Holland Dozier Holland, called Where Did Our Love Go?
It was a sexy song, and I say anybody that can sing through this song has a hit record. I say it's not a doubt in my mind.
Making matters worse, many believed that the Marvelettes had turned down the chance to record it first.
I often wonder what did the Marvelettes say about that now, because once they hit that hit, Barry just focused all his energy behind the Supreme.
The Marvelettes turned it down, and I said, thank you, girls.
But did they really turn it down?
There was never a consideration of anybody but the Supremes. You know, but like I say, the person that said this might have been teasing the Marvelettes and just playing this, hey, what do you all think of this? And them teasing back might have said, well, we don't like it, or whatever. You just never know, but it was never meant for them, never created for them.
Into each heart, some tears must fall.
As it turned out, the Marvelettes got busy recording another song that became a top hit as well.
20 Fish in the Sea. Such a driving record. And they felt in their hearts they made the right decision. I think they did make the right decision. Too Many Fish to Sea is a beautiful record.
I said, short one, tall one, diamond, kind one.
don't know how Where Did Our Love Go would fit into our repertoire, because we were used to doing fast-paced songs. And our destiny was Too Many Fish in the Sea.
Too Many Fish in the Sea reeled in the number 15 spot on the R&B charts and number 25 on the pop side. Two more hits quickly followed, I'll Keep Holding On and Danger, Heartbreak Dead Ahead. By now, the Marvelettes had notched 11 top 30 singles in 3 years and were enjoying the perks of that success.
It was wonderful to see young ladies that came from Inkster, Michigan, come in with, opulence. You know, they started wearing mink coats and dress and all that. I said, wow, I was very happy for them.
Money, 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 money. Plenty of dough.
While Georgiana married Billy Gordon of the Contours, Catherine wedded the Marvelettes' road manager, Joe Schaffner. And Wanda married miracle singer Bobby Rogers. Back in Inkster, they made for a glamorous pair.
He would bring gifts to my mom. He knew what to do to win us over. When they were home together, they would just invite everybody over. I mean, the neighborhood would come to our house, you know, because here's one of the miracles.
It was a little incestual there at Motown. Yeah. Because it was our neighborhood. It was our neighborhood, and that's where that's where the pool is.
But trouble was never far from the Marvelettes. By 1965, Georgiana Tillman had been diagnosed with sickle cell anemia and lupus. That year, she left the group for good.
She cried. She cried real hard when she learned that she had to leave a group, that she wasn't going to be able to continue with this group. They told her the strain it takes to go on the road, it would elevate her sickness.
Wanda, Catherine, and Gladys vowed to carry on as a trio. More hits and more heartaches were on the way.
Eyes that hypnotize and all.
They said they always missed my mother. I guess the chemistry wasn't the same.
If we had a gig to do, Wanda would not show up. And I had hell on my hands.
By the end of 1965, the Marvelettes were a trio with a track record of hits and an uncertain future.
You had to deal with Martha Reeves and the Vandellas, and everybody knew Diana Ross. You were like third on the list, and you were not a powerful third.
It didn't help that many fans still couldn't identify who the Marvelettes were. They had risen to the top in the early 60s, when few black artists received much national exposure.
Please, Mr. Postman, which, 61, they were not on the cover. They had a mailbox on the cover. During that time, black people just weren't on the album covers, unfortunately. And then when we had our first hit record, we were on the cover, where the Marvelettes didn't get that sort of opportunity.
When they first broke big, and we're talking early 60s, what outlets? There weren't too many opportunities for them to be seen on television. When the Supremes came along, things started changing. Temptations, Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, they benefited from all of that television exposure. But the Marvelettes, they kind of faded away.
Or so it seemed. But as their star began to dim, Smokey Robinson began crafting songs for the group, with Wanda Young's voice front and center.
When Wanda started singing, "Don't mess with Bill, don't mess with," it was so sexy, it was so smoky, and it was, just great.
Don't mess with Bill. Don't mess with Bill.
he hurt something in one. And then after he got that first hit, I mean, it was like, hey, she matches my style.
Well, I know he's the guy who put tears.
Don't Mess With Bill hit the top 10 on the pop and R&B charts, becoming the Marvelettes' second gold record.
Wanda became the voice of the Marvelettes. She was dynamite. She had the charisma, she had the smile, she had the looks on stage, and she could really get a song across.
Very few times a group have been able to have two lead singers and make it work. And so, yeah, they had a second life.
The hit also shifted the power within the group. Gladys Horton was still the Marvelettes' driving force. But as the trio got back on tour, Wanda was clearly their star.
She enjoyed entertaining. She enjoyed being on the stage. She said it just pumps you up. You feel good, you know. And she loved it. She loved it.
But for Wanda, the high of performing slipped sharply into other highs.
Wanda became a user and abuser of drugs. And she became almost a gopher. That's what I call it. Because she went for anything that she could get high on.
It was addiction. And you fear that they're gonna OD. But a lot of people in Inkster would console her and even contribute to her illness.
If we had a gig to do, Wanda would not show up. I couldn't go through too much more of that. It almost caused for me to have a nervous breakdown because she was just so out of control.
But Wanda could still deliver in the studio. And in 1967, she sang lead on another Sublime classic from Smokey Robinson. The Hunter Gets Captured by the Game.
Every day things change.
He was the hunter, and she was the game, and she captured him. And from there, I said, wow, that's a heck of an idea. You know, that's a heck of a song.
Ooh, you were the kid that I was after.
Wanda, many could say, was the female Smokey Robinson, and she interpreted his lyrics, much like he did with the Miracles, and then later as a solo artist. She had a sweeter voice than Gladys.
Hunter gets captured by game.
She was a little bringing it, but you know, there was a difference there in their vocals, which served them very well.
Hunter captured the number two spot on the R&B charts, the Marvelettes' highest position there since Postman back in 1961. But their success masked a group in crisis. That same year, Gladys Horton took a leave of absence when she became pregnant with her first child.
You could see that she was expecting. And so they didn't want that to be happening. And back in the day, that wasn't happening.
And when Gladys's child, named Sammy, was born with a mental disability, she decided to leave the Marvelettes for good.
So the fame and the money didn't mean anything to her. You know, she was pregnant. She wanted to spend time with her son.
To stop doing what she loved, to stop doing what she was making money at, to take care of that baby of hers, it took a lot of heart, a lot of something special, you know, in her.
Through all their ups and downs, Gladys Horton had been the Marvelettes' unifying figure. Her departure threw the group into a tailspin.
That affected it tremendously, you know, more than anything.
It's like losing part of your body. You have to learn how to work and maneuver with your other hand. Gladys leaving was really overwhelming. And I had hell on my hands.
The Marvelettes were down to two and counting.
I was almost begging, please don't leave me. Please don't leave me. Because it had to be some sanity in there.
By 1968, the Marvelettes had scored a dozen top 20 hits and were coming apart at the seams. The five friends from Inkster were down to just two. To keep them going, Motown replaced Gladys Horton with Ann Bogan, a veteran singer who looked and sang the part.
I felt honored and lucky to be asked to sing with them. And I enjoyed it, too.
Her voice was really, really dynamic. I love Ann's voice. I was for her all the way.
But by now, the Marvelettes were a group on stage only. In the studio, Wanda Young was backed mainly by Motown's house singers, the Andantes.
Eyes that hypnotize, and all it takes is just one glance.
That formula yielded one final top 10 hit, penned by Smokey Robinson, entitled My Baby Must Be a Magician. But there were no TV appearances to boost its sales. And as Wanda's condition worsened, longtime members of the group's support team began to abandon ship.
I would talk to him. Tell him, please don't. I was almost begging, please don't leave me. Please don't leave me. Because it had to be some sanity in there.
Wanda's married to Bobby Rogers, original member of the Miracles. And I think that's what saved her a lot of times from them maybe often to get her, put her out of the group, because she had that touch.
I went to the quote unquote managers and told them that, you know, she was out of control. I don't want to go through this anymore. And because they weren't interested at all.
You can take the hose to the water, but if they don't want to drink, then. But she didn't really realize that she was as sick as she was.
As the Marvelettes unraveled, so did their music.
We could have got a little better writing. We could have got a little more exposure and a little more time, more personal time and consideration than we did.
The Marvelettes' last album featured only Wanda singing. So Catherine refused to pose for the cover.
Why in the hell would I take and come down there to do a photo shoot when you don't even think I'm worthy enough to sing background? So, no.
In the end, the album cover showed Wanda with two other figures whose faces were blurred out. A picture that was all too revealing.
The bottom line is, they didn't care anything about me, so why would I care anything about them? Especially when they're supposed to be a quote-unquote family.
There was no final tour, no official end. By 1970, the Marvelettes simply ceased to exist and silently faded from view.
And that's the way it concluded. I mean, Motown never did say that it's over for you all, or we never did say to Motown that we quit or anything like that. We just disbanded.
After 10 years and 18 top 40 hits, the Marvelettes were through. But a final series of indignities remained.
There were at least, you know, five different Marvelettes groups.
She can't use her own name, Marvelettes, and she created it?
Rain, and this old world seems
By the early 1970s, Motown had packed its bags and moved headquarters from Detroit to L.A. Most of their top stars followed suit. The Marvelettes were not among them.
The music industry can be wonderful to you. It can be cruel to you. After a while, people forget about you. You become unsung.
Indeed, the Marvelettes' legacy became so undervalued that a businessman named Larry Marshack began organizing groups of unknown singers and billing them as the Marvelettes.
I know the first time we did a show, you know, we pulled in town and we didn't know who's on the show, but we got the mic, oh, the Marvelettes. I said, I didn't know they were still the Marvelettes. So I ran there to see them, you know, and they're younger than my kids. How are they the Marvelettes?
How could you just lie? I mean, we're in a world now where you just lie and you say, this is my group, I'm a Marvelette.
For a while, few seemed to care, since the real Marvelettes weren't performing anymore. Their former leader, Gladys Horton, was now a single mom with three boys, including Sammy, her oldest, who remained seriously disabled.
One thing about Gladys is she wouldn't, like, go out dating or go out nightclubbing or partying and having fun. She was always about taking care of her children. And Sammy, rather than institutionalizing him, she decided to keep him, and she took him every place that she went, she would take him, and if he wasn't welcome, then she wouldn't go.
We were her world. She didn't need a man at all, you know, to raise us. I mean, she was happy, just her and her boys.
But as her kids grew older, Gladys reached out to Catherine and Wanda to bring the Marvelettes back together. It didn't work.
I didn't want to do a reunion because I had been through hell with Gladys and with Wanda. So why would I want to go back out there with that?
There was a period where Wanda had, you know, promised my mother she was going to try to clean up. And I believe Wanda had cleaned up for a while. You know, but she just kept relapsing.
So eventually, Gladys hit the road on her own. That's when she found herself competing with Larry Marshack's version of her old group.
There were at least, you know, five different Marvelettes groups running around under the same aegis, going out there, you know, at very low prices.
They would go around and perform and even actually tell people that they were Gladys Horton, the original lead singer.
These other phony groups were performing for so much cheaper, it actually made it difficult for her to get the money that she deserved.
Then, Gladys's problems took another surreal turn. As she began billing her own group as the Marvelettes, friends contend that Larry Marshack threatened to sue her.
Anytime she tried to use the name the Marvelettes, you know, these people showed up with this document.
She was angry. She's out there. She can't use her own name, Marvelettes, and she created it? Yeah. Very, very angry.
She had a very, very difficult time being chased around. You know, many promoters who wouldn't hire her, you know, because she couldn't use the pure name. You know, and she was very much the victim of this.
Besides the Marvelettes, other popular groups, including the Platters and the Coasters, have accused Marshack of infringing on the use of their names.
We finally got this legislation that unless you have one, at least one original member in the group, you cannot call yourself by that name.
But for Gladys, that legislation came too late.
She couldn't get good legal help. You know, she didn't have any money. She had a son with cerebral palsy. Life was difficult for Gladys.
She was having a series of strokes. She had woke up one morning and her mouth was crooked. Kind of like she just got kind of ill overnight.
She was in the hospital for a while, but a lot of it had to do with a broken heart, just being there, not being able to use her creativity, and it just kind of drained her life from her.
Gladys Horton died in a nursing home in Los Angeles in January 2011. She was 65 years old.
She was the woman who sang Please, Mr. Postman. You know, you can never take that away from her. She was the real deal, and she should not have had to go through this.
While Gladys had been struggling to revive her career, Wanda Young stayed in the shadows while battling her own inner demons. In 1989, a British producer named Ian Levine came to Detroit and organized a show that put Wanda briefly on stage, along with several other Motown legends.
I've seen so many of my old Motown buddies and artists that I worked with from the year 1962, when this was 1989. And every time I start talking, I just want to cry out because I'm so happy to see so many of my people. Oh, just have to cry.
Wanda would continue to struggle for decades. But in recent years, she's begun to emerge from her addictions with the help and support of her family.
She's sober now. Yeah, she's sober now. I think she's thankful she's here because she's been told, you know, the things you've done, people don't wake up from them.
It makes me feel good when I hear the Marvelettes on the radio. They still love us. I can't believe it. They still love us.
Georgiana Tillman, who left the Marvelettes after contracting lupus and sickle cell, died from those diseases in 1980. Catherine Schaffner, Juanita Cowart, and Georgia Dobbins all continue to reside in the area around Inkster. And in 2011, 50 years after the Marvelettes first got together, and 43 years after their last hit, Inkster returned the love.
You never forget your history, and you never forget those who went out and represented your community and their families, and it's a positive feeling.
It's important for us as a city to honor them. You don't honor your own, who will?
You had the Beatles and all kind of people that, you know, re-recorded it, and it's still good dance music.
Anyone that sells a million records and it takes 43 years for you to even get your recognition, it's unsung.
I just want to thank, you know, the fans. If it wasn't for the fans, look, there would be no Marvelettes. Come on, fans, give yourself a hand.
In recent years, Motown has honored the Marvelettes with two box sets anthologizing their music, including dozens of songs which were never released in their heyday. And if the individual members of the Marvelettes have been all but forgotten, their legacy and their music remains timeless.
What's this old world coming to?
If you're on an elevator and you hear a Marvelettes song, you'll probably sing it. You'll hum along with it, but you don't know who did it, except those of us who were there.
The legacy is this glorious output of beloved music.
It just fell into place, the voices, the music, everything. If you wasn't feeling good, you just put on a Marvelettes record. Hey, you would feel better.